My NAS, or Network Attached Storage Device, was quickly running out of space. I've had a Synology DS1520 Plus with 5 8 terabyte drives for over 4 years now. It had 30 terabytes of usable space, and I was using 28.4 of those terabytes. Now, Synology starts to warn you about low disk space when you hit 20% free space remaining, so I went well beyond that threshold. I knew I had to upgrade the NAS, but it was a project that I was absolutely dreading. I use this NAS for a ton of stuff. I mean, besides being the main data storage for all of my YouTube footage and my documents, pictures, music, it also runs virtual machines such as Home Assistant that automates a lot of devices around my home, and Docker containers such as Pi-hole. Moving all of that stuff to a brand new device with enough storage to last me for another 4 or 5 years was gonna be a serious challenge. Or maybe it wasn't gonna be as difficult as I thought it would be. In this video, I'm gonna talk about the new NAS that I'm upgrading to, and I'm gonna go over all of the steps that I took to migrate so that if you're faced with a similar project, hopefully it won't be such a mystery. All right, let's get started. The friendly and helpful technicians at Rogue Support are experts in more than just networking, wireless, and security. They can also help you with your network attached storage needs. Whether you're working with TrueNAS, Synology, QNAP, or many other brands, we can typically help you get the most out of your data storage. So check out Rogue Support on the web at rogue.support, open up a ticket with a description of your issue, and get the help that you need today. And there's no upfront cost. You don't pay a thing until your issue is resolved. Give us a shot. You won't be disappointed. My new NAS is the Synology DS1821 Plus. It has an AMD Ryzen quad-core processor running at 2.2 gigahertz. By default, it comes with 4 gigs of DDR4 ECC RAM, but it can be upgraded to a maximum of 32 gigabytes, which I'm absolutely going to do. I've actually already ordered the RAM. I'm just waiting for it to arrive. And we'll talk a bit about why I'm upgrading the RAM in just a little while. The DS1821 Plus has 8 drive bays for either 2.5-inch or 3.5-inch hard drives. For my own purposes, I populated it with 8 12-terabyte Seagate Iron Wolf drives. I also added in 2 of the Synology 800GB M.2 NVMe drives for read and write caching, which speeds up accessing recently used files. The DS1821 Plus has 4 gigabit Ethernet ports on board, but it also has a PCIe expansion slot on the side that I'm using for 10 gigabit connectivity with a Synology dual 10 gig card. Once I had the 10 gig NIC and all of the drives installed, I booted up the Synology NAS and I created a RAID volume. I went with Synology Hybrid RAID, or SHR, to create the RAID volume. SHR has some advantages over classic RAID in that it splits up every disk you install into equal size partitions, which allows you to have a RAID volume with different sized hard drives. In classic RAID 5, for example, if you used 4 1-terabyte drives, you would get 3 terabytes of total storage space. 3/4 of the total drive space would be for storage, and 1/4 would be for fault tolerance or redundancy. However, if you installed 2 1-terabyte drives and 2 3-terabyte drives in classic RAID 5, as in if you mix and match the hard drives, each drive is only going to be partitioned as much as the smallest drive in the array. So you'd only be using 1 terabyte worth of space for those 3 terabyte drives. With Synology Hybrid RAID, however, you can maximize RAID capacity because SHR will split that 3 terabyte drive into 3 separate 1 terabyte partitions, which increases the overall storage capacity and fault tolerance of the RAID volume. In my case, with 8 12-terabyte drives, I ended up with a volume that formatted down to just under 63 terabytes of usable storage with 2 full drives worth of fault tolerance. For full transparency in this video, Synology did supply me with the DS1821 Plus chassis, 2 of their NVMe drives for caching, and the 10 gig NIC. Altogether, that's $2,640 worth of hardware for my NAS configuration. However, I purchased the Seagate hard drives myself, which were $200 each, or a total of $1,600 for the 8 12-terabyte drives that I installed. All in, this new NAS configuration was $4,240. Okay, so let's talk about the migration. Since I was migrating from Synology to Synology, I wanted to try out the Synology Migration Assistant app, but I'm always personally nervous about those types of automated wizards, and I typically prefer to set everything up from scratch and then copy the files over manually. But I figured, you know, why not give the Migration Assistant a shot, and if it doesn't work for some reason, I can always just reformat and then do a manual migration. The Migration Assistant is an app that you install on the destination NAS because it pulls its data from the source NAS that you're copying from. The Migration Assistant is located in the Synology Package Manager right on the disk station desktop. Once I installed that app, it searched my local area network for other Synology devices and it found my old NAS immediately. It then asked for administrative credentials for the old NAS that it's copying from, and it showed me that it was going to copy over 29.1 terabytes of information, which it estimated was going to take 3 days, 14 hours, and 49 minutes, which is a long time. But that's what it takes to copy almost 30 terabytes of data across a gigabit NIC. And you might be saying, but Chris, I thought you installed a 10 gig NIC into the Synology NAS. And you're right, but the old NAS only has gigabit, so that's the bottleneck. Now, one more thing I learned about the Migration Assistant is that when the migration process started, it deleted the SHR or Synology Hybrid RAID volume that I had created when I originally set up the new NAS. So that actually was an unnecessary step. When migrating, it's best to just leave the drives on the new NAS unformatted and unpartitioned, since the Migration Assistant takes care of all of that for you. The first step of the Migration Assistant process is to prepare the new NAS volume and take a snapshot of the old NAS configuration. This process does take the old NAS offline, but that only took a few minutes, and then the files started copying over. Now, these files were copying over on average at about 100 megabytes per second, so the estimated 3 days and, you know, 15 hours or so was actually spot on. It did take that long to copy everything over. But 3.5 days later, once that copy was completed, I rebooted the new NAS, and then Synology popped up a notice about, you know, a few more manual steps that you might need to take in order to complete the migration. So for example, if you use Synology's surveillance station for cameras, you would have to manually reactivate any licenses that were applied to the old NAS. It also had me go into the package manager and run a repair on a number of the packages that needed to be reconfigured. I think there were like 3 packages in total, and it only took a few seconds. Now, when the Migration Assistant copied over my storage volume from the old NAS, it created a new volume of the same size on the new NAS. So the first thing I had to do was pop into the storage manager and then expand that volume to the max so that it took up the entirety of the available drive space of the new NAS. To do this, you just have to click on the 3 dots in the upper right-hand corner of the volume and choose Settings. Then you scroll down to Modify Size, you click Max, and then you click Save. The volume then expands to fill all available drive space, and that just takes a few seconds. I then created a read-write caching volume out of the available NVMe drives. To do that part, I clicked on my main storage volume, and then I clicked Create SSD cache. This then asked me if I wanted to use one of the NVMe's as a read-only cache, or do I want to use both of the NVMe's as read-write cache. So I chose to use both of the drives, and it assigned both of my NVMe's as caching drives for that main volume. As far as data storage goes, that was basically it. On all of my computers here in my office, the Windows, you know, My Documents folder, along with pictures and music and movies, basically, my entire user folder is remapped to a network drive on the Synology NAS. Now, I do this for a couple of reasons. First, it allows me to have the same exact users folder across all of my PCs to keep my data consistent. And second, it means that my own PC is mostly just a shell, right? If it crashes, I don't have to worry about losing data since everything lives on that NAS. To switch over to my new NAS, I simply had to remap the network drives in Windows to the new Synology NAS instead of the old one. Now, alternatively, I could have turned off the old NAS and then changed the static IP address of the new NAS to the same IP as the old one, but I just kind of wanted to keep this one online, you know, just in case. Once I remapped those network drives on all of my computers, my documents were successfully migrated. The next thing I did was to verify all of my backups. Now, I use a number of different backup routines in my network. For my own PC, I use Synology Active Backup for Business, which backs up my computer configuration once a week over to the NAS. For my working drive, which is an NVMe drive on my main PC, where all of my current projects live, like YouTube videos that I'm working on and stuff like that, I've got two backups. Now, both of these are rsync backups that run nightly. One backup goes to a USB-C attached 12 terabyte external storage drive, and the other goes over to the Synology NAS. And since my working drive is only a 1 terabyte NVMe and it's synchronized to both those locations, those backups are never more than 1 terabyte each. Since I don't want to only have stuff backed up locally, I also use Synology's Cloud Sync to back up nightly to Backblaze. And finally, I also use Synology's Active Backup for Google Workspaces to back up my Google Drive, email, contacts, and calendar for myself and all of my employees. Now, this synchronizes all of that data from Google nightly and then puts it into a folder on the NAS, which is also backed up to Backblaze. Going through your backup routines regularly gives you the opportunity to audit what can be improved. Now, those eagle-eyed viewers that are watching this video may have already spotted some issues with my existing backup routines. A good rule of thumb for backups is the 3-2-1 backup plan, which states you should have 3 copies of your data stored on at least 2 different types of media, such as the NAS drive, an external hard drive, etc. And you should always have at least 1 copy off-site, either in a separate physical location or in cloud storage. I am not passing the 3-2-1 test with my existing backup plan for all of my important data. So that means I should take the time now to improve the backup workflow. For example, my Windows configuration is only backing up to the NAS and then backing up to the Backblaze cloud storage. Now, to me, this is actually okay. It doesn't pass that 3-2-1 rule, but you know, by and large, my Windows desktop is just a shell, and rebuilding it from scratch isn't the end of the world. My working folder backups do meet the 3-2-1 rule, as I have a copy on my PC, on my NAS, and on an external hard drive, and then another copy synchronized to the cloud nightly. But my documents folder, pictures, music files, videos, my users folder in Windows is not meeting the 3-2-1 criteria, and that is super important data. If my NAS dies, or if my house burns down and it's destroyed, I'm relying on only the Backblaze cloud storage for those files, which is not great. That's a third-party cloud organization that I don't have any control over. Also remember that just because the files are on the NAS, that doesn't make them a lot safer. RAID is not a backup. I mean, it keeps your data safer than having it on a single disk, but it's not completely infallible. So after realizing this in my audit, what I'm gonna do is move my external USB hard drive to the NAS, and then use it as an additional file share for the network. That way, I'm gonna be synchronizing my documents, pictures, video, etc. to both the NAS and the external hard drive locally, and then I will still have that synchronized Backblaze cloud backup as well. Now, it could be made even better if I had a secondary offsite location that was under my control, but this is gonna do for now, and it will definitely help me sleep better at night. Next, I tackled Docker. Right, I only have a single production Docker container on the Synology NAS, and it runs in the Synology Container Manager, and that is Pi-hole. So Pi-hole is a network-wide DNS server that blocks adware and malware for your clients. Definitely a great project to install in your networks, and I do have a full video on how to install Pi-hole that I will link to in the description below. My Pi-hole Docker container was also migrated over perfectly with the migration assistant, and since it was a straight copy of the old Docker container, it even had all of the stats and log file history included. Now, the only issue is that my Synology NAS host IP had changed, right? So I now had to go into my router and change the IP address that the DHCP server is handing out to clients for DNS. And then since my DHCP lease time is 24 hours for all of my clients, I knew that they would all switch over to the new Pi-hole within a day or so. Now remember that I still had the old NAS up and running, so even clients with the old Pi-hole IP address were still working fine until they got that new lease from the DHCP server and started using the new Pi-hole Docker container. The final piece of the puzzle was the virtual machine manager, and this is something that I was actually pretty nervous about. I only have one virtual machine running in production on my Synology NAS, but it's a big one, Home Assistant. All right, so not only that, I have kind of an odd configuration, right? Home Assistant is used for controlling and managing all of these little like IoT devices that we have around our houses these days. I use it to control all the lighting in here, you know, monitor temperatures, control the thermostat, my aquarium, my sprinklers, and just, you know, basically everything runs off of Home Assistant. I've got so many automations going on that if Home Assistant is down, the whole family notices. So it's important to minimize downtime for that server as much as possible. And since Home Assistant is mostly used to control IoT devices, it lives in my IoT network, which is not the main network that my NAS lives in, right? So in order to get the NAS on the IoT network, I use a second Ethernet connection from the IoT network plugged into one of the 4 gigabit ports on the back of the NAS. So first I plugged in a cable and then made sure that the networking in the NAS was configured to have an IP address in the IoT network. Then I shut down Home Assistant on the old NAS. On the new NAS, I went into the Synology Virtual Machine Manager. I set the volume that it uses for virtual machines, and it found the Home Assistant virtual machine already sitting there because it had been copied over by the Migration Assistant. But when I went to start it, it failed, and it gave me an error that there wasn't enough RAM for the virtual machine. So I checked the settings of the old NAS, and I had Home Assistant set up to use 2 gigs of RAM on the old server, which the old NAS has 8 gigs of RAM total. The new NAS only came with 4 gigs of RAM, and I was already using most of that. So to fix this, I reconfigured the Home Assistant virtual machine to only use 1 gig of RAM, and then it started up no problem. All my automations worked perfectly, and all of my IoT devices were showing up as if nothing had changed. Because of the smaller amount of RAM in the new NAS, though, I'm basically at a point where I really can't run any additional virtual machines on that NAS, which is going to be a problem, right? So I don't like being maxed out on RAM, so I have now purchased 2 16 gigabyte DDR4 ECC SODIMMs from Crucial for $54 each. I actually just received these in the mail today, so I'll need to shut down my NAS for a few minutes to perform the upgrade. Crucial has a RAM compatibility tool on their website which told me which SODIMMs to buy for my model of Synology NAS, and purchasing direct from Crucial was actually cheaper than buying the same RAM from Amazon. And it was way cheaper than buying the official Synology branded SODIMMs, which were $350 each versus $54 for the Crucial ones. All right, final thoughts. What did I learn from all of this? First and foremost, the Synology Migration Assistant is absolutely awesome. It worked almost perfectly and made migrating from the old Synology NAS to the new Synology NAS really, really painless. Now, if I had known just how painless it was going to be ahead of time, I probably wouldn't have put off the migration for so long. Second, and this should go without saying, backups are important. I spent a significant amount of time verifying that all of my various local and cloud backups were working properly, and migrating to the new NAS was a good opportunity to audit that entire setup. Now, during that audit, I found that some of my backup routines need improvement. So I'm going to be making those changes soon to make sure that I don't lose any of my important data. Finally, if you're looking to add a network attached storage device to your network, you really can't go wrong with Synology. Right? Not only do you have options for whatever size data storage you need, along with easy to use applications for backing up all your data, there are a ton of additional features that really make the NAS the centerpiece of your entire home lab or business infrastructure. It can do virtual machines, Docker containers, central authentication such as Radius or Active Directory. It has media services such as Plex. I mean, there's just so much that you can do that go beyond simple data storage. It's really, really worth giving Synology a good look. And as far as the migration from one NAS to another goes, like most things in IT, your success or failure greatly depends on the amount of organization and planning that you do up front. All right, don't dive into a project like that blindly. Take the time to research and study how it's done first, and your chances of success will be vastly improved. Okay, thank you so much for watching, and if you'd like to keep this party going, I have hand-selected a couple of videos on the right here for you to watch next. The top video is my recent first look at the UniFi 16-port ProMax switch with Ether lighting, and the bottom video is my review of the Starlink Gen 3 satellite dish.